Ms. Dixon, welcome.
Good morning, Chairwoman Stabenow, Ranking Member Bozeman, and members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to testify today. I'm so honored to be here, and I look forward to discussing the Digital Commodities Consumer Protection Act. My name is Danelle Dixon, and I am the CEO and Executive Director of the Stellar Development Foundation. Before I speak about the opportunities that are presented by the DCCPA, I'd like to share a bit more about the Stellar Development Foundation and the Stellar Network, and most importantly, the real-world solutions built with this technology. The Stellar Development Foundation, or SDF, was established alongside the Stellar Network in 2014 with the mission of creating equitable access to the global financial system by using the underlying technology presented by Stellar. The Stellar Network is an open, permissionless, decentralized ledger, or a blockchain network, optimized for payments and asset issuance, particularly useful with stablecoins in payments. Today, rather than talking about the things that we read about in the press with respect to trading or speculation, I'd like to highlight a payment service that was built on Stellar, launched in the dead of the crypto winter this summer. In June, MoneyGram, Circle, and a growing number of digital wallets launched a first-of-its-kind global service that enables anyone to convert cash to digital assets without a bank, without a bank account, without a credit card. This service utilizes the Stellar blockchain and Circle's USDC coin, it's a stable coin, to allow cash funding and payout in different currencies all around the world. The Stellar Network provides the digital rails to make payments fast and secure. USDC provides a truly stable digital asset. And while MoneyGram provides a global network of cash-in and cash-out locations, this is true interoperability with the existing financial system. In practical terms, what this means is that an immigrant farm worker in Michigan or Kansas or California or anywhere in the world can send her hard-earned cash to her family and to her home country without experiencing outsized fees or uncertain wait times. She can walk into a local MoneyGram location, typically a supermarket or a pharmacy, with $100 in cash, and in minutes from start to finish, she can convert that $100 into virtual dollars in USDC. And that's deposited directly into her digital wallet. On the other side of the transaction, her parents could visit their local MoneyGram location and cash out of their own USDC from their digital wallet that she sent to them into their local fiat currency when they need that. This is available right now and is being used right now. This novel service gives neglected, unbanked, underbanked, and cash-reliant populations a pathway to enter the digital economy.
Yo, what is going on, everyone? Welcome back to the Zen Lounge. In this video, I'm going to be doing an in-depth breakdown of Stellar Networks. You just seen me introduce Danelle Dixon, the CEO of Stellar Organization. And I'm going to show you guys through the lens of if you guys believe in the Illuminati, like a hidden organization that runs the world, and they were hand-selecting projects that they wanted to succeed, my money would be on Stellar Networks is one of them. Remember, this channel is not financial advice. We're going to be looking at this from the lens of an investigator and a researcher. So you can see one of the reasons I'm doing a video on them in the first place, the World Economic Forum had a huge event called Davos at the beginning of this year. And Danelle Dixon has been involved in some of the biggest stories of this year. She was also involved in the New York Times. I'll show you a New York Times article. She's basically doing humanitarian aid using Stellar Networks to help people in the Ukraine war. So there's been a lot of narratives with Stellar Networks. So I'm going to be showing you guys a bunch of cool information. And then also I'm going to be showing you a one-on-one chat with Jed McCaleb and a bunch of other cool videos showing how Stellar is going to be adopted. So one of the big narratives right now are stable coins. So one of the things, they're very close with USDC. And Danelle Dixon has been in, you know, talking with regulators for a very long time, going to Capitol Hill.
Thank you very much, and very much appreciate all these suggestions about further ways that we can improve this legislation. So thank you very much. Ms. Dixon, colleagues on the House Financial Services Committee are working on a bill to regulate stablecoins, as we know. How would that legislation interact with our bill, giving the CFTC the authority to regulate digital commodities?
Thank you, Senator. It's such a great opportunity to be able to have these bills work together. Having a clear definition of what truly is a stablecoin is so important. We already see in this bill there's a process for listing stablecoins, but it's really important because a lot of what we read about in the early days of the summer focused on things that were labeled stablecoins but were not one-to-one backed with fiat, didn't have audit requirements, didn't have the transparency that we think is important not just for American consumers but also for business who want to leverage these stablecoins, as I mentioned in the MoneyGram example. So creating that very clear definition of what is a stablecoin, holding those assets in a secured financial depository account, making sure that you can't have, that if you do have a run on the bank, that there's not going to be a problem for the constituents that choose to get their money out. These are all really, really important pieces that we think need to be addressed, and we see not just the bill in the House, but also the proposal that Senator Gillibrand and Lemus put together with respect to stablecoins and defining stablecoins. We'd love to see the idea that we continue to have innovation in this space, but it is regulated innovation around stablecoins.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And I have numerous other questions, but I'm going to stop at this point.
So as you guys could see in the previous video that I just played, Danielle, the CEO of Stellar, is really connected, so connected. The regulators are even asking her opinion on how they should set up the framework for stablecoins. In the post February 15th, she says, one-to-one fiat-backed stablecoins are not securities. And nothing that's happened this week changes that statement. This is regarding Paxos' issuance of BUSD. I believe it's called, it's connected to Binance, a stablecoin that the SEC targeted as security. And there was a lot of FUD and fear in the market. Everybody was wondering, is my stablecoin safe? And I believe Danielle is coming in defense of USDC. You see, USDC is highly dependent on Stellar Networks. It's what MoneyGram uses. And she says there are players in the market that operate responsibly with consumers and regulators in mind. Secure one-to-one fiat-backed stablecoins are crucial to this industry. These stablecoins enable incredible products and services that expand financial access. When we sift through the chatter to the actual news that came out this week, nothing indicates that we're facing an existential hurdle. And then she basically is just calling for a legislative framework. And that's what we need most urgently, a legislative framework. This is what all the crypto industry people are saying that want to do things the right way. A legislative framework that establishes clear standards and rules of the road that protects consumers and set builders and companies up for success. So let's watch and learn from the actual news as it comes out. And let's not get caught up with the FUD. And we should focus on the incredible creativity in this industry to build the trust of regulators and consumers alike. So who was just at Davos? Another person at Davos was USDC Circle. Circle has, let me show you. I think I already showed you guys this. Circle is connected to BNY Mellon. Circle is connected to BlackRock. Circles connected to Coinbase. And I did hear that Coinbase actually was one of the people that snitched on Paxos. So you can see some dirty games are being played, but Circle is connected to the BlackRock. That's how BlackRock plays the game, connected to Stellar, connected to the world's elite. So that's what this video is kind of showing you. Here it is. Known as a fully reserved stablecoin, every digital dollar of USDC on the internet is 100% backed by cash and short-dated U.S. treasuries. So it's always redeemable one-to-one for U.S. dollars. USDC reserves are held in custody and management of leading U.S. financial institutions, including BlackRock and BNY Mellon. I also seen a reporter got fed a fake news clickbait article saying that USDC got issued a Wells notice. The lady ended up having to delete this tweet because USDC people came out and said, this is not true. This is FUD. This is baseless. There's been a lot of FUD out there. Who knows? You know, there's going to be a lot that happens in this financial transition. Let's just show that Stellar. And because look, we could see that MoneyGram, where is it? So MoneyGram uses USDC, and this is part of this whole humanitarian project. This is the next thing that I'm going on. So Stellar, when I was researching Stellar, when I first got on the crypto, all these rumors that Jed Michaela was connected to the Lucius Trust. And you can't really find much information about Lucius Trust, but Lucius Trust is like a fund from the United Nations. And that was like the speculation. And now there's full proof. So in this next part, I'm going to show you clips and teach you guys about this new thing that Stellar is known for, is basically giving quick cash to displaced people in crisis situations. So if you know about the United Nations, I believe they're involved in like Agenda 2030. So basically, they're probably going to create these crisis events in order to deploy this humanitarian, you know, digital currency, new world currency. And it looks like Stellar is going to be part of that. So I'm going to show you a bunch of clips. So you can see the New York Times. You can see some of my research on it. So it's pretty crazy. So UN Refugee Agency launches a pilot cash-based intervention using blockchain technology on Stellar Network. So this is big stuff right here, guys. This is big stuff. The rumors, conspiracies seem to be true.
Humanitarian aid serves as a lifeline to over 100 million displaced people in crisis around the world. Unfortunately, distributing aid to displaced people at scale can be a challenge due to high costs, damaged infrastructure, fraud, and a lack of transparency to ensure aid goes to those who need it. Now, with Stellar Aid Assist, relief organizations can use a first-of-its-kind blockchain solution to deliver aid instantly, transparently, and globally. Stellar Aid Assist leverages the power of Stellar, a proven, decentralized, and open blockchain network to get money into the hands of those who need it quickly and at a low cost. It's fast to deploy and can scale easily to meet a moment of crisis. Here's how it works. Your relief organization can use Stellar Aid Assist's innovative bulk disbursement tool to deliver aid directly to your own pre-approved lists of recipients in the form of digital currencies, like Circle's USD coin, USDC, a fully reserved dollar digital currency. Recipients can then access their aid directly from their phones using participating digital wallet applications without needing a bank account. Finally, they can choose to hold their digital assets as a safeguard against local currency devaluation or exchange them for physical cash at one of MoneyGram's hundreds of thousands of participating locations around the world. With Stellar Aid Assist, relief organizations can feel confident their aid will be delivered transparently over the blockchain, instantly at scale, and at a low cost. This means your aid recipients can access their relief funds digitally regardless of where they are, in stable currencies like digital US dollars, all without a bank card or account required. Stellar Aid Assist makes aid accessible for all and enables equitable access to aid. Learn how Stellar can empower your organization or the organization you donate to deliver the future of aid today. Visit stellar.org/aidassist.
regarding the digital assets and digital currencies.
Два тижні тому я вже бачив пілот електронної гривні в Україні.
2 weeks ago, I saw a pilot of electronic e-hryvnia in Ukraine.
На, тобто ми в цьому напрямку співпрацюємо з Stellar компанією і з одним з приватних українських банків.
In this regard, we are cooperating with Teller company and one of the Ukrainian private banks.
На, і я навіть планую стати першим, скажімо, тестувальником електронної гривні і почати отримувати електронної гривні заробітну плату.
And I plan on becoming the first test user of the electronic hryvnia, and I plan to receive on receiving my salary in e-hryvnia.
Але якщо спиратися на законодавство, то Національний банк планує наступного року, 2024 році, запустити вже масштабні пілоти в напрямку електронної гривні.
As far as the legislation is concerned, the National Bank of Ukraine plans to introduce legislation in 2024 on the introduction of the electronic hryvnia.
І як я вже говорив, ми окремо прийняли законопроект про віртуальні активи.
As I mentioned already, we have passed a draft law on virtual assets.
І в цьому році я планую, щоб ми прийняли податковий законопроект і легалізували повністю, ну, знайшли відповіді на всі питання щодо віртуальних активів.
And as I said, we're planning on addressing the taxation side of it so we could have a complex comprehensive approach to the legalization of all.
It is the future. We're pioneering the future of delivering aid. And that's what's so exciting about it. It is just going to be one more rail for aid organizations to leverage. It includes lots of players in it, but most importantly, it starts with the ability to do bulk uploading of transactions and immediately get them sent to individuals' wallets all over the world. And so you can do thousands of transactions at once. And so this is the tool that was developed for these aid organizations in conjunction with using the Stellar network. So it goes very quickly. The aid can be uploaded in seconds and then sent in seconds to a digital wallet. And the digital wallet can be a wallet anywhere in the world. We're happy to be using Vibrant right now in the Ukraine with the UNHCR. And then you have the USDC token, which is the value that we're using in this particular project, but you could use any stablecoin anywhere in the world. And then we have MoneyGram on the ground so that you can actually have the on and off ramp so that you can, what we're seeing right now in the project is that individuals, those internally displaced persons in Ukraine, are able to download the wallet and receive their aid in 2 minutes and 30 seconds. So it's a pretty remarkable thing. That's registering, that's doing everything they need to do in that time period and then cashing out. So it really is the ability to do this whole pipe in such a short period of time, but it puts the individual in control of their own assets. They can hold their assets if they choose to. They can immediately cash out. They can put it into their bank account. It puts them in a powerful position. And we're targeting, the UNHCR is targeting some of the most individuals in the most challenged situations. So it's giving them an opportunity to feel empowered in a situation where they don't have any control over what's happening.
So now let's get into some of the tech upgrades. So today they posted the latest initiative to increase Stellar's transactions per second. Also, Danielle posted this, something that I resonate with. She said, a good read in history and lovability of Rust. One of the reasons she's posting about how Rust went from a side project to the world's most loved programming language. Read this whole article. I'll put it in the description below. For the past decade, coders wrote critical systems in C and C++. Now they turn to Rust. Actually, a lot of people in the crypto communities love Discord. You know that Discord was coded in Rust? And Rust is actually one of the languages of WebAssembly. And you guys know me, I'm a big fan of WASM. Stellar smart contracts are going to be in WASM. And one of my favorite projects, are actually Cosm WASM based projects, Cosmos Smart Contracts Virtual Machine. And I personally believe Rust and WASM is better than Solidity and EVM. So Danielle posts why people are loving Rust. So I'll put this in the description below for you guys to read. Most importantly, there's a new initiative to increase Stellar's transactions per second, but lots of innovation happening on Stellar Network. So let me read real quick. So Stellar is not currently limited by transaction per second. The network's maximum rate is set at 200 transactions per second. So that could be raised by a community where validators to vote through. Basically, you can vote to increase it. And basically, this new initiative, this pool mode is set to initiate. The results show pool mode increasing the maximum transaction per second by 72%. This is likely because pool mode decreases the computational power necessary to validate a transaction. So basically, the transactions per second are going to increase by 72% with this new Stellar upgrade that they're proposing. And they're going to talk about that, actually. I'm going to go now into a chat that happened 3 months ago, so this isn't exactly new. But I watched it. I enjoyed it. And Jed McCaleb is an OG, and I think whenever he speaks, I do listen to what he says, and he says a lot of good things in this, including touching on the transaction per second topic. So enjoy this next clip, and I'll be back over here on the other side.
I think there was one, someone raised their hand over here. Oh, okay, we'll go there first. We'll come back.
My name is Bisi Adedokun. I'm the founder and CEO of Oroki. I want to ask, where do you see Stellar in the next 5 years? And do you see a convergence between the Stellar protocol and the Ripple protocol?
Sorry, do I see a what between them?
A convergence between the Stellar protocol and the Ripple protocol.
Oh, I don't know if it'll be a convergence. I mean, I think we're working on very different problems, actually. Like, it sounds the same on the surface, but I think we're trying to do fairly different things. You know, in the next 5 years, I mean, I hope Stellar, like, continues to grow, obviously, and I think it'll grow along things like Vibrant that I think we're going to talk about later, things like that, where it's actually, like, essentially enabling these, like, cross-border payments, you know, in a kind of decentralized way, in the sense that, like, anyone can plug into this network, like lots of different, like, small players and things like that. So, you know, hopefully that gets established in, like, certain regions in the next 5 years is what I'm hoping. So, yeah, sort of vague, but
also I kind of feel like the way blockchains are heading is, like, interoperability is becoming more and more important. So, you know, people are doing things multi-chain. So, you know, I think you maybe, like, 5 years ago, it seemed like there might be, like, one chain might emerge as, like, the blockchain, and that doesn't seem to be happening right now.
But maybe picking up on that and what Alex was talking about, you know, thinking about building out an ecosystem, are there specific things you guys would like to see built on the network soon that you think kind of over the next 5 years will be really important to our success?
Yeah. I mean, all the stuff I'd like to see built is—it's like fairly boring. It's just, you know, continuing to add, like, anchors to the network so there's more assets, like more high-quality assets, and then continuing to have more interoperability between different, you know, payment providers and like, so it's like kind of simple stuff, but like it's the stuff that actually makes it useful and like and where, you know, people have some actually value out of this network, right? So it's nothing like shiny, but yeah.
I mean, I guess there's, you know, I'm, you know, at heart, like, I'm really an engineer, so I get excited about, like, the shiny objects over there. So we've been talking about some, like, scalability stuff that really isn't necessary now, but, like, if we're successful, we're going to have to, like, massively scale up, and I think there's going to be some, like, really neat technology for scaling transaction rates, so I'll be excited to see that built when the need arises.
There was someone over there who had a question.
Hi, Marcus from Script3. Mostly out of curiosity, what consensus mechanism research are you guys currently excited about?
Yeah, I haven't been following, like, the other things that closely. Yeah, so I don't really have a good answer. Do you have anyone who's been looking at?
Yeah, I mean, I'm jaded, so, like, okay, like.
Okay, well, maybe on the kind of competitor track, though, there was a question we wanted to ask you guys about and kind of related to transactions. Do you think Stellar could handle the traffic of one of the top networks like Solana or Ethereum if it came tomorrow?
I think we're already past.
Yeah, we're way past Ethereum. I mean, it's, you know, I think it's, you know, because Stellar has like not just payment transactions, but like you know, the exchange built in, and exchanges use like way more traffic than like just like a payment network. So we actually do like quite a few transactions per second compared to other things out there in the world. So I think we would handle it fine. I don't know.
I wish people would like banish the term transactions per second and talk about like payments per second and trades per second or something. Those would be like more useful metrics.
Yeah.
I wish I could put up the realtps.net website right now so you guys could see what networks actually process Stellar's rank very highly, just so you know. I think one question here.
Just hi. Central bank digital currencies. What is the development there? I mean, there's a central banks that are very arcane and bureaucratic institutions, and you got Stellar, which is on steroids. What's that experience been like in terms of adoption and the central bank's willingness to switch?
Yeah, I mean, it's a long road, obviously. I think there's a lot of interest from like central banks around the world about like blockchain in general, not just Stellar. But I think it's like a, you know, it will be a long process before they actually like put stuff on there, I believe. But yeah, I don't know. So.
Switching again.
Yeah, I guess I talk to more central bankers from like a Stanford point in my Stanford job than the Stellar job. My sense is that a lot of central banks they're relatively conservative, right? So it'll probably so all the stuff that's happening now with like stable coins and stuff is great for like de-risking and showing the potential value of a CBDC.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, I think what David's saying, like, the stakes are really high for building a CBDC when you're a government institution. So I would recommend you find Paul Wong, who's on our team, and he heads up our CBDC work. So I'm sure he'd be able to tell you a little bit about things we've built in some of the G20 tech sprints, particularly around CBDCs on Stellar. All right, we are basically – oh, wait, okay, you're the last one.
What do you see Stellar in 5 years? What are the problems that we need to solve right away? There's been a new focus on financial inclusion, disabilities, geopolitical instabilities. What are the issues that Stellar as a network needs to solve now?
Yeah, so I mean, I think, part of it we'll talk about tomorrow. I think we do have to add smart contracts. That's like in our roadmap now. And I think that that's increasingly clear that that's like a fundamental thing for just allowing the diversity of what people want to build on this platform. So like that's, I think, our number one thing that we need to add. And then there's like scale, like hopefully then that will lead to like needing more of these scalability improvements that David's like mentioning. Those are kind of the two main things. So, yeah.
All right. You know, nothing to add? Because now I'm going to ask a question I think you're both going to hate as my wrap-up.
Okay.
Okay, we're in Rome. Have you guys eaten gelato yet? No?
No.
No?
Not yet.
No.
Not yet.
Okay.
Tomorrow.
Right. We got to keep it on the agenda. Yeah. Okay. And also, now it seems like there's a lot of questions about smart contracts. Come back tomorrow at 10 a.m. So thank you, Jed and David, so much for this chat.
Thank you.
Really appreciate having you guys on stage.
Hope you guys enjoyed that video with Jed McCaleb. He touched on a lot of good topics in that video, including a lot of people spread rumors that Ripple and Stellar are somehow competing, and he says it. When you actually listen to the developers, they actually speak the real truth, not the rumors that you hear online, that Ripple is working on a set of problems and Stellar focusing on different problems. But they're both working on really big problems. You can see, if you look at the Stellar Development Foundation, there's tons of updates to what the developers are working on, including tokenization. You guys know me, I'm a really big fan of tokenization. I think tokenization is going to be huge, and Stellar is definitely after that market as well. So you could see right here, you could tokenize any asset on Stellar in a matter of 4 steps. You could tokenize basically any asset that you want. So Stellar is more open source tools. We have to understand that the future is multi-chain, and every chain, every network has its unique benefits. And it's almost like saying that only one internet would be used, right? There's going to be so many different
internet websites that won Web 2. There's going to be so many different protocols, networks, blockchains, distributed ledgers, DAOs, NFTs that win this next bull cycle. So that's the beautiful thing. Interoperability is going to be bigger and more. There's going to be more interoperability in the next bull cycle, which is going to allow, you know, higher highs, I think. So, you know, I'm really excited for the future. Hope you guys like this deep dive on Stellar. I think Stellar is one of those projects that are way too big to ignore. Seems like some of the world's elite is involved in this project.
I think that's right with respect to traditional crypto. Traditional sounds
traditional as in five.
Yes, a few years. But the Stellar network is really optimized for asset issuance. And so from before there really was a term stablecoin, there were assets being issued on the Stellar network that were backed by fiat currencies. And so I'm not aware of any algorithmic stable coins on the Stellar network. They're USDC and other fiat currencies that are backed. And so it's capturing all of the benefits of this technology for transparency, for speed, for security, and minimizing that risk of the volatility, because these are the stable coins, and we're working very diligently to try and make sure that we have the appropriate regulations to, you know, there are a lot of good actors in the space who are leading the charge, but some of those good actions that are not regulated and not codified yet need to be codified. But that's one of the ways that you get rid of that volatility concern. Because, for example, in Argentina, the whole point of using the blockchain technology is so people in Argentina can avoid the volatility of their own currency and hold it in a dollar-backed token.
So I hope you guys enjoyed this video today. If you enjoy my content, please give me a thumbs up. Please subscribe. Please leave some comments on your thoughts. Do you think Stellar is a chosen network by the world's elite, or do you think I'm just a crazy conspiracy guy? All right, guys, everybody have an awesome day. Peace.